I want to thank you for the invitation to present some remarks and to participate in what I am sure is going to be an interesting question and answer period to follow. And I say interesting because over the 18 months in which I've served as president of the Federal Reserve Bank of Cleveland, I find that whenever I present remarks, I learn a lot from the questions posed by the audience, most likely more than what they learn from me. And I do view the exchange of ideas with the public as one of a Fed president's duties, but it also has turned out to be one of its pleasures. Now, another pleasure of mine is serving on the Federal Open Market Committee's subcommittee on communications. The Federal Reserve has worked over many years to improve its communications with the public and to increase transparency. This work is gratifying, but it's also challenging. And one of the challenges is trying to explain policy decisions and the rationale behind those decisions, which can be quite complex. In a world in which every word of the FOMC is scrutinized, those of us on the committee try to be very careful with our language. But at times, this can make us seem somewhat inscrutable. So today, I'm going to try to give you my own interpretation of four expressions that have become part of the lexicon of monetary policymakers. These phrases are data dependent, gradual normalization, well underway, and symmetric inflation goal. Now, before proceeding, let me emphasize that this is not intended to be an exhaustive list of the lingo monetary policymakers use. If I tried to do that, we'd be here all night, and we'd probably never get to the Q&A portion of the program. Let me also emphasize that these are my views and interpretations, and not necessarily those of the Federal Reserve System or my colleagues on the FOMC. So the FOMC has described its monetary policy decisions as being data dependent. At its January meeting held last week, the FOMC decided to maintain the target range of the federal funds rate at 0.25 to 0.5%. This target was set in December when the FOMC implemented its first change in the policy rate in 7 years, and the first rate increase in 9.5 years. December's increase in the rate was from essentially zero recognized the considerable progress the economy has made since the Great Recession, which officially ended more than 6 years ago, and the FOMC's outlook that the economy will improve further, supported by monetary policy that continues to be quite accommodative. The committee has indicated that in setting policy, it assesses both realized and expected progress towards the FOMC's statutory objectives of maximum employment and price stability. The decision to maintain the target rate in January, just as the decision to raise it in December, represents the outcome of such an assessment. This assessment encompasses a wide range of economic information. The official economic statistical releases and financial market indicators, as well as the information that I and other FOMC participants garner by speaking with contacts in our regions. When the FOMC says its decisions are data dependent, I view this as shorthand for this more comprehensive process of parsing economic and financial information to evaluate current economic conditions, and then assessing what that information implies about the economic outlook and the risks around that outlook. I supported the decision of no change in the Fed funds rate target in January because I believe that policy, for the time being, is well calibrated to the economic outlook and the risks around that outlook. Now, it's important to note that data-dependent policymaker does not mean that policy will react to every short-run change in the data. For example, volatility in financial markets or a change in a short-run data report is not a rationale for making a monetary policy decision. Instead, an assessment has to be made of what the incoming data and financial market developments are telling us about the underlying economic conditions and the medium-run outlook. The relevant time horizon for monetary policy is the medium run because it takes time for monetary policy to have an effect throughout the economy. A case in point is the economic and financial developments we've seen since the beginning of the year. According to the first estimate, real GDP growth slowed considerably in the fourth quarter of last year to an annualized growth rate of 0.7%, down from an average pace of about 3% in the second and third quarters. A decline in net exports and a reduced pace of inventory investment were the main drags on growth last quarter, but non-residential investment also declined. In contrast, consumer spending and residential investment held up well. So the question is, how long will the softness seen last quarter persist? We also have to evaluate what the recent market volatility might imply about median-run growth. The declines in global equity markets since the beginning of the year partly reflect market participants' reassessment of the outlook for growth in China and their views on how effective policy actions undertaken by Chinese policymakers will be in fostering growth there. China is undergoing a longer-run structural transition from an economy driven by trade to one more dependent on domestic consumption growth. And these kinds of structural changes can be challenging and long-lasting. Over the past couple of decades, we've seen some of those challenges play out on a much smaller scale at the regional level in the U.S. as industrial states have transitioned from manufacturing-based economies to more diversified goods and services-based economies. Now, as it relates to U.S. growth, the direct trade ties between the U.S. economy and China are not very strong. Exports to China represent 7 to 8% of total U.S. exports, and total U.S. exports are about 12 to 13% of U.S. GDP. So the direct effect of trade with China on U.S. output is small. Of course, some U.S. industries are more exposed to international developments via trade and changes in the value of the dollar than others. And because many emerging economies are considerably more dependent on trade with China, the implications of developments in China for the global economy need to be considered. In addition to the decline in stock prices, we have seen another sharp decline in oil prices since the beginning of the year. In part, this reflects the same reassessment of global growth prospects affecting the stock market. But supply-side factors are also very important. Worldwide oil inventories remain high, and oil production has not been as responsive as one might have thought, given the declines in oil prices seen over the past 18 months. This means that oil prices are likely to remain lower for longer than previously anticipated, as it's taking longer for supply to rebalance with demand. Now, how should a data-dependent policymaker incorporate these recent developments into the medium-run outlook? At this point, I view them as posing some risk to the outlook, but I believe it's premature to materially change my modal outlook. The drop in oil prices means that the U.S. energy and manufacturing sectors will continue to experience considerable pressure. However, lower energy prices will provide an offsetting benefit for U.S. households and for those in other importing countries. Households may choose to spend some of this gain. We've seen this already in high sales of SUVs and other larger vehicles. Or they may choose to save some of this gain. We've seen the savings rate rise. And these savings will help support future consumption. While there's a possibility that a steeper, more persistent drop in equity markets could lead to a broader and more persistent pullback in risk-taking, which would negatively affect the outlook, so far, we have not seen this. I continue to monitor global economic and financial developments and assess their implications for the outlook and risks to the outlook. At this point, solid labor market indicators, including strong payroll growth and healthy growth in real disposable income, suggest that underlying U.S. economic fundamentals remain sound. Until we see further evidence to the contrary, my expectation is that the U.S. economy will work through the latest episode of market turbulence and soft patch to regain its footing for moderate growth, even as the energy and manufacturing sectors remain challenged. I continue to expect that growth this year will be sufficient to generate some further improvement in labor markets. Now, I wouldn't be surprised if the pace of job gains slowed somewhat, but the gains should be strong enough to put additional downward pressure on the unemployment rate. The latest round of oil price declines means headline inflation will remain lower for longer than I previously thought. But I still think a reasonable forecast is that inflation will gradually return to 2% over the median run. Now, I can point to a couple of things to support this view. First, measures of underlying inflation, like the core, the trim mean, and the Cleveland Fed's median CPI, are higher than headline inflation. They've remained relatively stable despite the continuing sharp drop in oil prices we've seen over the past 18 months, and the appreciation of the dollar, which puts downward pressure on the price of U.S. imports. In my view, longer-run inflation expectations, an important factor in the inflation forecast, have been relatively stable, even in the face of sizable declines in energy prices. I take less of a signal from the downward moves in market-based measures of inflation compensation, because estimates suggest that these moves more likely reflect changes in liquidity premia and inflation risk premia, rather than changes in inflation expectations. Oil prices cannot continue to decline indefinitely, nor can the dollar continue to appreciate forever. At some point, both will regain some stability, and the effect of previous changes on inflation will dissipate. As that happens, with inflation expectations remaining stable and economic growth continuing, it is reasonable to expect that inflation will move back slowly to 2%. It just might take a bit longer now, given the most recent decline in oil prices. Of course, going forward, it will be important to monitor inflation developments, in particular inflation expectations, as well as economic developments both here and abroad. As we've seen, things can take unexpected turns. We want to set the path of policy based on an outlook informed by economic developments, a path that will best achieve our objectives of maximum employment and price stability. While the actual path the Fed funds rate follows will depend on the economic outlook, and thus will be data dependent, my current view is that economic conditions will evolve in a way that will warrant rates moving up gradually over time to more normal levels. And this brings me to the second term in the monetary policymaker's lexicon, gradual normalization. I expect monetary policy to remain accommodative for some time to come. But given my outlook of moderate growth, continued improvement in labor markets, and a gradual return of inflation to 2%, I believe the appropriate policy path will involve gradual reductions in the extraordinary level of accommodation that was necessary to address the Great Recession and its aftermath. The FOMC's Summary of Economic Projections, or SEP, which includes a dot plot of each FOMC participant's Fed funds rate projection, gives a good sense of the meaning of gradual normalization. In March, we'll have a new set of FOMC projections. The December projections showed that the majority of FOMC participants believe it will be appropriate for the level of the Fed funds rate to move up over time, but at a pace that means over the next couple of years, the funds rate will be below the level most participants expect to prevail over the longer run. According to the December projections, across participants, this longer run level ranges from 3 to 4%, with a median projection of 3.5%. So one meaning of gradual is that the level of the policy rate is expected to be relatively low for some time. Another way to see that this pace is gradual is to compare it to past tightening cycles when, of course, economic conditions and the outlook differed from those today. The median path in the December SEP is about half the pace of tightening the committee undertook in the 2004-2006 period, the period of measured pace increases. It's even more gradual when compared to the 1994 tightening cycle, when the Fed funds rate target rose by 300 basis points over 13 months. A third way to view this as gradual is to compare it to prescriptions from some simple monetary policy rules. Now, as I've said elsewhere, I believe in a systematic approach to monetary policy, but I don't believe we're at the state of knowledge where we can choose a single policy rule to set policy, because no rule works well enough across a variety of economic models and in a variety of economic circumstances. Still, I find it useful to look at the outcomes of a variety of such rules as a gauge. The median policy path in the December SEP is more gradual than the policy path that would be prescribed by many, although not all, simple policy rules. For example, suppose the economy evolved in the way described by the median economic projections from the December SEP. then the simple Taylor 1993 rule would project the Fed funds rate rising by over 3 percentage points by the end of 2017. While the median appropriate policy path in the December SEP is considerably more gradual, with the Fed funds rate rising by about 2 percentage points by the end of 2017. In other words, according to FOMC participants, in order to achieve the median economic projections in the SEP, a more gradual path than the one described by a simple Taylor rule will be appropriate. Thus, it's anticipated that even as policy gradually normalizes, it will likely need to remain accommodative for some time to come, given some of the forces still impacting our economy. For example, slow growth abroad, dollar appreciation, more restrictive financial conditions, and the continued rebalancing of supply and demand in the energy sector. Now, we use the word normalization, but in the aftermath of the Great Recession, there's some uncertainty about what the normal level of interest rates is. If productivity growth remains low and the potential growth rate of the economy over the longer run has moved lower, as many economists estimate it has, then the longer run level of the Fed funds rate consistent with price stability and maximum employment, the so-called neutral rate, would also be lower than it was in earlier periods. But estimates of long-run growth are imprecise and subject to revision. So this means there's considerable uncertainty around this neutral Fed funds rate as well. A gradual approach to normalization will not only allow us to be responsive to economic developments, but also allow us to recalibrate policy over time as some of the uncertainties surrounding the longer-term level of interest rates, the economy's potential growth rate, and the longer-run unemployment rate are resolved. Now, while I've been using the median Fed funds projection in the December SEP as a benchmark, it's important to keep in mind that these projections are not a commitment, because in order to best achieve our goals of maximum employment and price stability, policy should be expected to react in a systematic fashion to material changes in the outlook. Our economic forecasting models are, by necessity, simplifications. The economy is dynamic and can be hit by various shocks that might lead to changes in the median run outlook for employment and inflation to which policy would want to respond. Confidence bands around economic forecasts tend to be wide. For example, averaging across several models, the 70% confidence interval around a forecast of CPI inflation over a 1 year out is about plus or minus 1 percentage point. The confidence band around a forecast of short-term interest rates 1 year out is of similar magnitude. Unlike private sector forecasters, FOMC policymakers provide funds rate projections in the SEP that represent their views of appropriate policy rather than a policy forecast. But because there's uncertainty around the outlook, there's also uncertainty around the FOMC's policy path. If the economy's evolution turns out to be different from what we currently anticipate, our policy path may well have to deviate from what our current expectation is. The policy path in the SEP will change over time as the outlook changes. I don't view this as problematic. We want policy to respond appropriately to changes in the outlook. Thus, the actual path normalization takes could very well turn out to be either less or more gradual than what we anticipate it to be today. The evolution of the FOMC's dot plot in the SEP over meetings to come will provide the public with information on how participants think monetary policy should appropriately respond to changes in the outlook. And as I mentioned, our next SEP will be released in March. Another aspect of current monetary policy involves the Fed's balance sheet strategy. The Fed took some extraordinary policy actions in the wake of the financial crisis and Great Recession. Some of those actions involved purchasing longer-term Treasury securities and agency mortgage-backed securities to exert downward pressure on long-term interest rates. As a result of those purchases, banks and other depository institutions now hold at the Fed over $2 trillion in reserves in excess of regulatory requirements, and the Fed holds about $4.5 trillion in assets on its balance sheet, nearly five times as much as before the financial crisis. Currently, the Fed is maintaining the size of its balance sheet by reinvesting principal payments from its holdings of agency debt and agency mortgage-backed securities into agency mortgage-backed securities and by rolling over maturing Treasury securities at auction. The FOMC has said it anticipates doing this until normalization of the level of the Fed funds rate is, quote, well underway. One might reasonably ask what well underway means. The FOMC has not given a precise definition. In my view, well underway refers to the state of the economy and not a particular length of time after the initial rate increase. This is consistent with the FOMC's policy normalization principles, which indicate that the decision about when to cease or begin phasing out reinvestments will depend on how economic and financial conditions and the economic outlook evolve. As demonstrated in December, the Fed has the tools to raise the Fed funds rate to the target range, even though the balance sheet is very large. So from a policy implementation perspective, there isn't a compelling reason to end reinvestments quickly. But consistent with the normalization principles, I would like the balance sheet to eventually return to a more normal size and composition. The first step in that process is ending reinvestments. We don't know precisely how the economy will evolve. This argues against deciding to end reinvestments after some particular period of time has elapsed. Instead, because some policy accommodation is provided via the balance sheet, it would seem better to base the decision about reinvestments on economic conditions and the outlook, just as we do with the funds rate path. Indeed, the economic conditions and outlook that would support reducing the degree of monetary accommodation by gradually raising the Fed funds rate would also tend to support slowly reducing the size of the balance sheet, which would result when reinvestments end. Thus, in my view, the level of the Fed funds rate might be used as a guide to when to end reinvestments. In this case, both our Fed funds rate path and our balance sheet policy would be data dependent. I'd be comfortable ending reinvestments after we have a few more funds rate increases under our belt, perhaps when the funds rate has reached 1% or so. This is my interpretation of well underway, but as Chair Yellen indicated in her December press briefing, the FOMC has not given further guidance on this. The final phase in the monetary policymaker's lexicon I'd like to discuss is the FOMC's symmetric inflation goal. The FOMC's statement on longer-run goals and monetary policy strategy serves to clarify the FOMC's framework for making monetary policy decisions. I view the statement as a very important part of the committee's communications arsenal. This statement makes explicit the FOMC's numerical goal for inflation over the longer run. This goal is 2% inflation as measured by the year-over-year change in the price index for personal consumption expenditures, or PCE inflation. Since first being issued in January 2012, the statement has been reaffirmed at the committee's annual organizational meetings each January. Given that it lays out the FOMC's decision-making framework, I view the statement on long-run goals as somewhat constitutional in nature, but periodically the FOMC and its subcommittee on communications appropriately consider whether there are any changes that might be beneficial in clarifying the framework. One such change was made this January when the FOMC clarified that the 2% inflation target is symmetric. As indicated in the statement, the committee would be concerned if inflation were running persistently above or persistently below the goal. Persistent one-side misses can be of concern because in many models of inflation, of the inflation process, current and past deviations from the target are informative about future inflation. Another factor affecting the outlook for inflation is inflation expectations. Persistent misses on either side of the goal can be of concern because they might ultimately cause inflation expectations to become unanchored, thereby undermining the achievement of the Fed's longer-run inflation objective. Now, these concerns may or may not rise to the level of necessitating a policy action. The FOMC has to balance a number of considerations in setting policy to promote its dual mandate goals of maximum employment and price stability. As we discussed, policy action is tied to the median run outlook. If the one-sided misses have changed the outlook for inflation and employment materially, then policy might need to respond in order to foster attainment of our goals. In other cases, even if inflation were running above or below the target, no policy response might be called for because the outlook continued to be for inflation to return to 2% over time and for the economy to be at full employment. An example is the period in late 2006 and early 2007. The minutes of the December 2006 FOMC meeting indicated that the economy was expected to expand at a moderate pace, and all FOMC participants were concerned about inflation. Nearly all participants felt that the core measures of inflation were, quote, uncomfortably high, end quote. Part of the increase in both headline and core inflation reflected earlier rises in energy and other commodity prices. The FOMC continued to forecast that core inflation would move lower over time as the effects of higher energy and commodity prices passed through and growth moderated. They expressed concern that if inflation didn't moderate as expected, there would be significant costs if inflation expectations drifted up. But on balance, these concerns did not elicit a change in the Fed funds rate, although there was one dissent in favor of raising rates in light of the inflation outlook. Similarly, in meetings in early 2007, the committee was concerned about inflation, but the forecast was for inflation to moderate and there was no policy response. In the aftermath of the Great Recession and our experience with low inflation, I have not heard many people say that they believe that the Fed interprets it as its inflation target as a ceiling and is only concerned about misses on the upside. Nonetheless, I do think the change the committee made in January to clarify the symmetric nature of the inflation target was a positive step toward improved transparency and communications. And I hope that my remarks today help to clarify for you my own interpretation of four catchphrases in the monetary policymaker's lexicon: data dependent, gradual normalization, well underway, and symmetric inflation goal. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Loretta. That was very interesting. Loretta's joining me here at the table, and she's going to take your questions. Before we start, I would just like to ask that the reporters not ask questions during this portion. You'll have an opportunity later in an adjoining room, as you know. I'm going to take the privilege of asking the first question. You said it is premature to change the outlook in wake of recent global economic and financial events. And you said policy is still well calibrated. Can we take that to mean that you still think the December funds rate projection of four 2016 rate hikes remains appropriate for now? And just how persistent would those developments have to be to change your prognosis? What kind of things will you be looking for?
Okay, so as I said, right, you have to think about the SEP as not being a forecast, right? So basically, the SEP, or Summary Economic Projections, every FOMC participant gives a forecast for the economy and then the appropriate policy path that it'll take to get there. So the four rate increases you're talking about is the median path in the
right.
SEP, but there's variation around that. Different participants put in different projections. Now, you know, My as I said in the speech, you know, my view right now is that I still see a path of gradually upward Fed funds rates over time being appropriate. I'm certainly going to take the time between now and the next meeting to assess conditions. Certainly the developments we've seen in financial markets, right, are relevant. I'm going to look at tomorrow's employment report in the context of all the other data that we're going to be getting in and assessing that. You know, so we look at a whole panoply of data. I also talk to my contacts in the region to get a handle on, you know, what they're seeing. One thing I found of interest was that in the beginning of the year, when, you know, the start of some of the turbulence in the financial markets was going on. I asked, you know, my directors and other contacts, you know, what about risk preferences? What, you know, what are your customers telling you? Are they pulling back from risk? And at that point, they were not seeing that. In fact, if anything, some said that the low interest rates was actually spurring more risk taking. So again, you have to look at the whole panoply of data. And my, you know, I'm certainly going to take the time between now, right, and the next meeting to do that kind of assessment of both, you know, my outlook and the risks around that outlook. But if, you know, you put me on the spot today, I would say I haven't seen enough to want to change my modal outlook, where moderate growth, some further improvement in the labor market, and the fund, you know, the inflation path coming up to 2%. Granted, I did push out my timing of that because we've had that other oil price shock.
Was there anything in particular that you would find alarming, for example, a much reduced rate of job growth or you know, particular financial stimuli that you'd be concerned about?
I mean, I do think that, you know, we had very strong job growth, you know, at the end of last year. I wouldn't be surprised if we see some weaker job growth because of the demographics and where we are in the cycle going forward. But certainly job growth strong enough to continue, you know, putting downward pressure on, right, on the unemployment rate and lowering long-term unemployment and the other measures that people look at to talk about underemployment. So again, you know, yeah, we want to look at that. We want to look at consumer spending, right? The consumer is an important part of the outlook. It'll be, you know, interesting to assess whether the tightening of financial conditions, right, will that last, won't it last? I mean, that's the kind of thing that we have to look at. And that's why we want to take the time to look at those kind of things over time, right? In September, if you remember, we saw a tightening in financial conditions, and that unwound itself. So again, I think it's premature to come up with an assessment today.
Okay.
It's one thing good about meeting every 6 to 8 weeks is that you can take the time to actually use that time to assess things and not be, you know, being sort of responsive to very short run, run movements.
Okay, I'll open it to the floor then. Loretta, you select.
We had this all planned out that I was going to call on people, and then I forgot, right?
So I appreciate the fact that the Fed wants to be transparent, but we all know that transparency is a function of forecast accuracy, and forecasting is more of an art than it is a science. So I'm wondering, is it really right for the Fed and the other central banks to have the level of independence that would allow them to get into policies that are so experimental that we have the level of negative interest rates in Europe and we've held rates here at zero for almost 8 years? Is there some process that we, the people, can have to assure that the Fed is within its boundaries of what it's supposed to be, other than the two Humphrey Hawkins meetings that we have where we report to Congress? Is there too much independence of the Fed, and is the Fed really as accurate in its forecasting capability to allow you to have the level of transparency that you think we have?
Okay, that's a lot of questions in there. Okay, so it's very important that monetary policy decisions not be affected by political considerations. So when we say that the Fed has independence in making its monetary policy decisions, it's not that it's not accountable for those decisions. I think of those as being very separate things. And what it does mean is that we are basically not having to having short-run political considerations affect monetary policy decisions. And there's a whole body of research, both here and abroad, that basically says independent central banks, independent in my definition of what independent means, lead to better economic outcomes for the public. That doesn't mean that the Fed shouldn't be held accountable. And so, you know, you mentioned the two Humphrey Hawkins testimonies, but Chair Yellen, I think, you know, if you look at how many times she's testified, many more times than that, she's, you know, any time that Congress asks her to come and testify, she does. She does speeches routinely. She does her press briefings. Those were added by Ben Bernanke when he was chair. Now she's continued them. So I think that she's being very responsive. And the goal of that is to try to explain so that people can hold us accountable. I think transparency is very important because the public needs to see what we're doing in order to be able to hold us accountable. So I don't think anyone in the Fed would say, you know, give us independence, we're going to go off and do whatever we want, and, you know, see you later. I think it's very important, right, for us to be transparent, because it is important for the public to hold us accountable. But I also think that, you know, there's some, you know, pending legislation that's, you know, going to try to take away some of that independence. And I can't support that, because all the things that I've studied all over the years basically say that if we do that, we will have worse economic outcomes, because policy won't be independent from these short-run political considerations. I think we'll learn over, you know, time, you know, how things, you know, with, you know, some of the quantitative easing and, you know, as you say, negative interest rates. But, you know, I have to say that the alternative, if we hadn't done those, I wouldn't have wanted to contemplate. So I think they were effective. Those were, you know, well done for the conditions that we were in. I like the fact that we're now gradually raising the fund rate and reducing gradually the level of accommodation. I think that's consistent with my outlook. But of course, if things, you know, turn out to be more downside than I'm anticipating, then we want to be responsive to that.
Both or all three of the, you know, peso crisis, the Asian tiger crisis, and the Argentine collapse. And if you go back to Soros's sort of breaking of England, they were trying to pull off the impossible trinity at the same time, which is, as you know, fixed pegged currency, independent monetary policy, and free capital controls. They seem to have finally trying to release some of that pressure. They've released some of the yuan, and now they're ratcheting down on capital controls. The two camps building, one, that they can implement policy as they're doing now, releasing some of the mortgage pressure, releasing reserve ratios for banks, ratcheting down capital controls such that they don't break open in a sense. The other camp is they're running out of reserves. They have big trade flows, obviously, so they need a large amount of reserves to sort of control that. People see the $3.5 trillion as some giant number, but when you're considering how large their economy is, it's really not that big. I sort of see the line as sort of $3 trillion, mm-hmm. where if they go below $3 trillion, you start to really break open what they've been trying to accomplish. What do you think?
Thank you.
You know, certainly, right, the reassessment of growth prospects in China and, you know, the evaluation of their policies and how successful their policies will be is I think, a factor in what's been happening in the financial markets. And it's certainly something that, you know, not growth there per se, but will it, you know, spill over and become a bigger financial situation? I thought you might talk about, you know, the health of the banking system there as well, because that's
Their bank debt problem is massive.
Yeah, because that's another place where there
and
could
that
be
ultimately
spillover.
Would be exposed, and yeah. That's what's happening. Their $3 trillion to me is sort of supporting that system. Right. And if you get below $3 trillion, if you think about a 5 to 10% default rate in a normal recession or recycle for corporate bonds, that's about a 7.5-8% to sort of control that $30 trillion of bank debt. So you get below that line, it's like not having enough gold in Fort Knox to support the dollar in a sense. And so below $3 trillion to me signals alarm bells along the system at the IMF, at the ECB, at the Fed. So there's obviously, I would believe, a lot more thought process that's going on at your level about this, because if they do break open, it's a you know, a bit of a cataclysmic event. Where you have 40% devaluation, 50% devaluation of the yuan.
So we could come up with scenarios, right, that would have that happening. And we can also come up with scenarios where, there isn't this sharp, you know, change in financial market. And that's something why we want to keep looking, right? So you're exactly right. You know, we can always come up with these worst-case scenarios. But, you know, is that, you know, and we have to take those into account because we care about the risks. Right, but again, you know, the likelihood of that versus likelihood, and that's part of the assessment that goes on when we're thinking about things. So, you know, I don't want to downplay the risk, right? But I also think that there's a lot of good things going on in the U.S. economy fundamentals are strong, the consumer side has been good, housing is coming back, and we also had to balance those good things against these kind of things. And so the financial market, you know, conditions we do take into account, has it impacts the U.S. economy.
Can I just ask, please keep your, we have a lot of very bright people in this room, and you have some great ideas, I'm sure, but try to keep your questions concise so we have more opportunities to, for more people to ask questions.
Right here, go ahead.
Hi, thank you for your remarks so far. You mentioned that you think that the appropriate federal funds rate at which to begin normalizing the size of the balance sheet is around 1%. Could you give us some more elaboration as to why you think that? Why 1%? Why not 2%? Why not a time frame? And then second, what does that mean when you speak about the normalization of the balance sheet? There are different scenarios that are floated out. Obviously, the Federal Reserve owns different kinds of securities. Right. How do you think about normalization of the balance sheet?
Okay, so, you know, I said 1% or so. I kind of would like us to get a little bit away from the zero, towards zero, just to get the funds rate up a little bit before we muck around with the balance sheet. I subscribe to the normalization principle, which says that, look, you know, the main policy tool is going to be interest rate, short-term interest rate. We're communicating it via the Fed funds rate, and that's kind of our principle. So we can leave the balance sheet alone and sort of get policy back toward moving towards a more normal way of doing policy. So that's kind of why I think. And, you know, if you get to a point where the funds rate is about 1%, right, then we're back to a more normal state of affairs, and then we can start thinking about reinvestments. As I said, I don't find it compelling that we have to do anything right now because we've shown that we have the tools to raise interest rates, right? I think early on people were concerned that with the balance sheet so large, right, we might actually have trouble raising the funds rate, and I think December rate increase showed that we have the tools. Because at some point we want to go back to a smaller balance sheet, right? I mean, I know the Fed is, we're doing, and we've said this in July, we're doing a long-term project, you know, about sort of what framework, operating framework the Fed will use. Will it go back to sort of how we did policy before, or now that we have the ability to pay interest on excess reserves, what size of balance sheet would we want to have? But in either of those cases, right, $4.5 trillion is not going to be, right, we've said in the normalization principles that we want to go back to a balance sheet as small as necessary to effectively do monetary policy. So at some point, we're going to have to start, you know, reducing the balance sheet. We've said, right, that we're going to let things trit off, you know, basically unwind. And the first step in that is basically stop reinvesting, because the reinvestment is just maintain the size. So, you know, it's basically just consistent with what we said we want to do, and at some point that'll start. And you know, and I can tell you, there's no real science about 1%. That's why I said 1% or so. It's just, to me, that feels compelling. Like, okay, once we get sort of away from zero on the funds rate, I think it makes sense, you know, to move. In terms of how you do it, you know, frankly, a lot of times I know that people in the financial markets, you know, want these precise, you know, things. My own view is I would keep it simple, right? I would reduce both, you know, I would stop the reinvestments both. I wouldn't do anything tricky, right? I mean, in some sense, it'll be gradual because not everything matures at the same time, so it is a gradual reduction, and that's how I would do it. But there's probably, you know, other people with other views about, like, what the best way to do it is. I just don't think we have enough science that would tell us to do one versus the other.
Thank you, President Mester. From a modern Fed history perspective, a case can be made that the abandoning of the risk assessment last week was a very big deal. It was reminiscent of March 2003, before the Iraq invasion, when geopolitical tensions were quite high and anxiety was quite high. I mean, certainly a case can be made that it's not as quite as formal a part of the statement as it used to be, and it wasn't done as dramatically. It was more subtle last week. But is it an overinterpretation that that was a very big deal for the committee to do that? And it was a signal, basically, that there's a large loss of confidence in the outlook. In other words, almost disregard the last set of SEPs. And just one other very quick question. Is there any chance we will get press briefings after every meeting anytime soon?
All right. So I speak for myself and not for Janet Yellen. So you'll have to ask her that question because she'd be the one doing the press briefings. I know she prepares for them quite a bit. So I would not be the one. I would not want to be the one who tells her that she needs to even do more work than she's doing to do more press briefings. But in any case, you know, I can only speak for my own view. I think, again, it was an attempt to be transparent, right? So what was the risk assessment? I think the conclusion, you know, was that, you know, perhaps, right, we should be transparent that, you know, we're looking at the data and we're monitoring economic conditions, and that it was reflected in the statement. So I would take the statement as my own view is I take that as being, you know, what a truthful statement. There is truth in that statement.
Got it.
Okay. I guess I should be following the microphone around. That's probably the best way to do it.
Anybody?
Got a lot of candidates.
There you go.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your remarks. And thank you for clarifying some of the lingo, as you put it, from the statement and other guidance. I wonder if you could clarify another item of Fed guidance, and that has to do with accommodation. How is accommodation measured? How is accommodation, in your mind, you mentioned at the moment that there's a good deal of accommodation, but I'm wondering how we can interpret the degree of accommodation and how it changes. And I'm asking this partly in the context of one of your colleagues, a former colleague now, Mr. Kochalakota, who left the committee. He felt that there wasn't enough accommodation, that in fact the committee's policy is tight right now. Mm-hmm. And that the economy could use more monetary accommodation. So it makes me wonder, well, how does the committee itself, or how do you actually measure accommodation? What is it? How do we know what is easy and what isn't?
Right. Okay, so let me preface this by saying different people on the committee will have different views of what appropriate policy is. And President Kochalakota, right, had a particular view of policy. So, you know, his view is that what economic conditions and his outlook necessitated an easier policy or more accommodative policy, right? And different people would have different views on the committee about that. In terms of the degree of accommodation, so, right, typically you'd say, you know, what's the neutral Fed funds rate, okay? And then are we more accommodative than that? We have negative, right, real interest rates. So to me, we are accommodative. Even if you think that the neutral Fed funds rate has come down, right, it hasn't come down enough, that would make us say we're not accommodative. So to my mind, right, we are very accommodative. And I think, you know, even if the long run neutral Fed funds rate is higher than the short run, which is what people, you know, estimates suggest, you still measure it against that, we're still quite accommodative. And that's how I view it in terms of sort of measuring accommodation. Now, that said, we know that the estimates around what neutral is, there's wide, you know, error bands around that. The estimates are not precise. But most of the estimates would suggest that we're very accommodative. And I think it's appropriate that we then start moving back some of that accommodation over time, especially if, you know, things work out according to my forecast.
Thank you for not saying R-star.
That's another piece of
jargon.
Yeah, right.
President Mester, thank you for coming to this evening. I have two related questions for you. The first is negative nominal interest rates are in a number of countries around the world. Do you think, given the structure of the U.S. economy, that would ever make sense for the Fed to implement negative interest rates here? And as a follow-up to that, given the political situation in the U.S., do you think that negative interest rates would represent a threat to Fed independence?
So, you know, I've said in the past that I'm a little skeptical of negative interest rates here. I think that, you know, our financial system is quite a bit different than others, and so, you know, while I take the experience in other countries as part of the data in which to evaluate it, I'm not sure that I can translate it necessarily. And, you know, how low can they go is also a question, right? So it has to do with, you know, what are the costs of holding cash, and, you know, that feeds into sort of how low you can move your interest rates low. So, you know, I have to say, now that other countries have done it and we have more evidence, you know, about, you know, we can look at sort of how well it's working, it's certainly something that, you know, I would, as a policymaker, it's incumbent upon me to look seriously at it. But I guess I'm still a little reluctant to go there, because I think our financial system is quite, you know, complicated, and I'm not sure what the effect would be. I have a feeling it wouldn't be that effective, and there are probably other things that we should do first. In terms of the independence, I mean, I guess the broader question is, one that we talked about earlier, is when you go to non-traditional tools, right, it probably is incumbent upon you to explain, you know, them, because they're new and people don't understand them. And frankly, you know, there's more uncertainty about them even within the central bank, right? So there's got to be this learning process. So in that sense, it might very well be that, you know, it would cause us some a reduction in independence. But again, the question is, you know, when you're in the situation that we faced, right, I think that in the balance is going to be that we did the right thing. The Fed did, or this before I was a policymaker, the Fed did the right thing. The FOMC did the right thing by going there. I think part of the history is going to be, though, also, can we move back from it, right? If you remember early on when there was a lot of skepticism about it, some of the people were skeptical because they thought that once we go down the path of QE and, you know, these kind of non-traditional things, it would be very hard to get out of it. And we haven't really done the whole extrication yet, so that remains to be written. I hope that we exit in a graceful way, because I would like to maintain those tools in the toolkit. I don't think we want to maintain them as the regular way of doing policy. But if we end up in a situation like we had, I hope we don't, but if we were to end up in that sometime down the future, I would like to be able to have those tools in the toolkit and not have to face the kind of situation you're saying, that this sort of, like, do you worry about sort of what the implication of that is for the institution? And so partly, you know, I think that it's incumbent upon us to be able to appropriately, right, move back to a more normal way of doing policy. And partly it's because I don't want to say, I say that not because we should never have done that in the first place. I say no, to the contrary. I think that was appropriate to do, and I'd like to maintain our flexibility to, if we have to, sometime in the future, you know, we'll be able to have those as tools.
Yeah, in terms of recent volatility, it seems in the past, over the past few years, whether it was taper tantrum, whether it was October 2014, whether it was last summer, August, the Fed has pulled back whenever we've seen period of volatility. Is there any changing view, or do you have a view that maybe some level of volatility is a necessary evil to get through to normalize policy, or is it once again going to be a very large concern?
Well, I mean, I think the assessment, you know, at least the way I look at it, is, you know, is the tightening of financial conditions, you know, going to persist in a way that will then affect the median run outlook, right? So it's not about volatility per se, right? It's about, right, is it going to be persistent and therefore, you know, have a material change in the outlook? So that's the way I approach it. But I guess I'm not that surprised, and I've said this in the past, that once we started down this path, that we'd see more volatility in the markets. I'm not that surprised about that. However, it's certainly something that we want to monitor and assess whether it's really going to change right, economic conditions in the U.S. So as I said in the speech, right, so far, right, it doesn't appear that there's been this huge, like, you know, pullback from consumers and other businesses want in what they're doing, but we need to look at that, and that's partly the evaluation and the assessment that we do until from now on the next meeting.
Thanks very much for your time. Just curious, kind of to that point, the recent deterioration of March hiking expectations in the market, how do you assess that, especially when thinking about, you know, not surprising the market, given that you guided it so well going into the December meeting, and thinking, you know, about potentially the consequences of doing so versus what is the appropriate path of monetary policy given economic conditions. Thank you.
Okay. So you're right. I mean, certainly the Fed doesn't want to do something that's going to be totally, you know, shocking, you know, to the markets, you know, and all that. But I guess I don't view that as the compelling reason to make policy, right? Again, right, I still think we have to take a step back, look at the median run outlook, try to do the best we can to assess, right, what current conditions are telling us about that outlook, and then setting appropriate policy. There are ways to communicate that, right? Speeches, Janet Yellen going out, you know, and talking. That's a way of communicating and hopefully, you know, getting the message out. But I think it's, I don't think that the Fed's role should be just to be a mirror to the markets. I think we need to sort of be a, you know, do the best we can. You know, we got to be honest brokers. This is where we're seeing the economy going and this is what our expectation is. I think market expectations will move, right, when the Fed moves. They move, they're more volatile than the Fed. They move around quite a bit. That said, you know, we do listen to signals from the market. You know, we try to assess what the data is telling us. So again, it's part of that assessment. But I still think that it's better for the Fed to do that assessment and base our policy on the outlook and the progress towards our goals, our statutory goals.
Thank you very much for your comments. Just returning for a moment to the question of reinvestment. When the Fed decides to suspend reinvestment, do you expect that's going to have an effect that's equivalent to a change in interest rates, or do you expect that's going to have unique impact on monetary policy in ways that IOER or other tools might not? Thank you.
Now, my expectation is that, you know, as the balance sheet, you know, we stop reinvestments, the balance sheet starts to change, shrink a little bit over time, that it'll essentially take out some monetary policy accommodation. Certainly with reinvestments, right, we're not talking about selling assets out of the portfolio, we're just letting them, you know, wind off gradually. I don't perceive that as being different. But at the same time, I think that over time, you know, you think back to the QE programs, right, the first, second, and third, right, the first one, you know, there was liquidity problems in the market, right? The Fed did its QE1, right? That had the biggest impact, right? Over time, as markets functioning got back, you know, back to normal, right? The effects that you would get on, you know, those risks, you know, the risk premium in those bonds, those effects are diminished over time, right? As markets are functioning and things. So I don't perceive that the QE and the amount of reduction we're talking about is going to be a hugely impactful in terms of taking monetary accommodation out. But again, right, the mechanism, I think, will be the same as that.
So the Fed is one institution that really seems to believe in a real normal. People talk about new normal, but you seem to believe in normal. The SEP, for example, takes us with few exceptions, maybe down a little bit from where the traditional sort of normal nominal funds rate would be. And in the policy statement, you have this thing that's beginning to look more and more like dogma. And this begins to bother me about the intermediate term, about how we're headed for 2% inflation, about how things are on path. And then you have these competing things about looking at being data dependent. And of course, dogma and data dependence are diametrically opposed. And what I've been seeing recently is an awful lot of rejection of market data that are bad, stock market data that begin the year with some of the worst selling that we've seen, and the vice chairman can't really say anything about it. The Fed statement doesn't really take a statement on the balance of risks. The non-manufacturing ISM weaker only 38% of the time. You know, when that index is at 50, it's weaker only 16% of the time. 50 is not a magic number. So I see an awful lot of weakness and an awful lot of talk from Fed officials that they just seem to want to dismiss it. And so I get the sense that there's dogma at work, that you have Keynesians and monetarists, and for different reasons, they think that things are tight. We're going to get inflation because of a low unemployment rate. We're going to get inflation because of a big balance sheet or because rates have been too low for too long. And this dogma is driving policy. And it's driving policy because it's a predetermined thing. And these data wiggles here and there, to me, seem to be dismissed. So what can you tell me to make me believe that the data wiggles aren't being dismissed?
Okay, so I can tell you that I'm not dismissing them, but I also, you know, my model, and, you know, the Cleveland Fed staff has their model, and every Reserve Bank probably has their own model, right? You know, we take those things into account. So like in the Cleveland Fed model, right, financial conditions, you know, we start off with that and then they run the model, right? So it's really a question of, you know, what is it telling you about the outlook going forward? So, you know, I admit the oil price shock, the subsequent decline that we got, downward shock, I had to push out, right, my path of the inflation path, right? So I do believe that the economy, right, is going to result in a 2%, you know, getting back to 2%. It's going to take longer than I originally thought. I don't find that a material change in the outlook in the sense that the dynamics are the same, right? So if I, when I look at, you know, core inflation measures, right, they're moving up. That's exactly the rash, that's exactly sort of what the dynamics that were in the Fed statement, right, is that, you know, once the effects of oil price shocks and dollar appreciation on import prices work through, right, we should see underlying inflation move back up. And at the beginning of the year, before the most recent, you know, downturn again in oil prices, that's exactly the dynamics that were happening. So to my mind, that's supportive of the view that it's reasonable to expect 2%. So it's not a dismissing of the data, it's just looking behind the data and saying, okay, what's it telling us? Now, the market volatility is something that in most cases, right, markets are going to be volatile. You know, it doesn't materially affect the medium and outlook for the economy, although we have cases where it's a more tremendous, you know, it's a bigger turbulence than it does. If it results in a big pullback of all risk-taking in the economy, in Main Street economy as well as Wall Street economy, then, as I said in the talk, right, that would be a material change in the outlook. But so far, we haven't seen that. So I think we are looking at the data. We are trying to assess what it's telling us about the outlook. And, you know, we're trying to do that the best we can. And I think, you know, we're all doing that. And then we come to the table at the FOMC and discuss our various views and then come up with the policy decisions. I want to just take 1 minute to talk about the statement and dogma. So there's some sense in what you're saying that I agree with, in the sense that it's like every change to the statement is noticed, right? Every word that changes. And so what you end up getting is very, you know, in some sense, language that, you know, stays in the statement there, you know, for many, many meetings to come, right? Which then just reinforces the, oh, if they make a change, you know, it's like, so, you know, and I've said this, you know, publicly and privately, it's like, I wish we could have a statement that you could just say what you think. You know, let's just like talk, you know, but we aren't there. But it is something that, you know, I would like to get to a point where we could actually write a little bit more and try to explain what we think. But remember, when it's fully there, there's 19 people sitting around that FOMC table. So, again, not wanting to add to Janet Yellen's burden, as we said, not giving her, like, you know, 4 more press conferences, I wouldn't want to put her burden on trying to get 19 people to agree to a bunch of changes and everything. That would be a really hard thing to do. But I grant your point that, you know, because of this way the statement is, the, where we are now, is it does give the impression of that, and that's not really what is happening.
President Mester, thanks for coming to New York tonight. I think the NABE is considering Cleveland for one of its annual meetings,
yes.
So we might be coming out to you soon. I had a question about the senior loan officer survey that came out this week. It suggested there was some tightening of credit conditions for large and small firms. We saw that back in the October one as well, and it's been a few years since we've seen this. In speaking to banks in your district, is that marginal tightening mainly concentrated in energy or manufacturing firms, or is it seeping out into other firms as well?
Yeah, so the bankers that we talk to, you're right, so it's manufacturing and energy, and most of the other bankers are reporting good conditions. There's a lot of competition for loans, But most of the ones in our district are not pulling back. It's more just competing for good credits. But that's another piece of the data that I'm going to be looking at, because I do, you know, that I think that's informative. I should also say that the NFIB, which, you know, does the survey of small businesses, they reported that hiring is going up in January, and that it's very difficult for firms to hire workers. So there's, you know, good news and bad news. And again, that's part of this assessment, is how do you balance those things out?
Hi. I was wondering if you could tell us what you really think about inflation. You seem to dismiss the market-based measures of inflation expectations. And, you know, even the Fed's measure of five-year forward inflation is at an all-time low at around 160 or thereabouts. And 30-year break-evens, which obviously are measured off of CPI, currently around 160. You know, they're roughly about 50 basis points above the CPI over the PCE. So the market is implying around 1.1% 30-year inflation as per the targeted measure at the Fed, roughly 1% away from your target. And, you know, the illiquidity premium that you mentioned maybe is worth 10, 20 basis points at most. The Treasury did cut the size of the TIPS auctions by $2 billion per month yesterday, but the break-evens didn't really move after that, not a lot in any case. And I just wonder if you could comment on that very significant disconnect.
Well, you know, I still think that the survey measures of inflation expectations are more reliable, especially when there's a lot of turbulence in the markets, like the quality flows into treasuries, the illiquidity of, or relative liquidity of TIPS versus nominal treasuries. So when I look at, and most of the estimates, if you, there are different models of actually taking, of actually estimating those liquidity premiums and inflation risk premiums, right? So they vary. Granted, the survey measures, right, you could argue that they're low, right? So we know that some of those are low, but they've been stable, and the underlying inflation measures, like the median CPI, which the Cleveland Fed publishes, they've been moving up. So again, right, I think there's good evidence to suggest that inflation expectations, despite the drop in oil prices, and for some reason, there seems to be a correlation, even in long-term expectations, when oil prices move a lot, right, there's correlation in long-term inflation expectations with the oil price. So I think that's affecting things as well. There's a nice paper by people at the economists at the Cleveland Fed that goes through that research. So again, you know, my view is the survey measures have been relatively stable, and I put more stock in them than I do the market measures, especially at times like this when there's a lot of, you know, turbulence in the markets.
Maybe just one more question, Loretta, and then I'll ask a final question. So,
lucky guy. hello, good evening. This election cycle has seen a rise in economic populism, and this has happened on both sides of the aisle. The Fed has become a bit of a punching bag for various economic discontent. And even though the current iteration of the audit the Fed bill is dormant, it's definitely not dead. Now, I definitely agree with you that transparency and communication is really the solution. But maybe what is transparent to the financial markets, to the people in this room, and to policymakers, may be ancient Greek to Joe Sixpack. And I just wanted to hear your comments on, you know, can that be addressed? Should it be addressed? Is it just something that the Fed does think about? Thank you.
Okay. So we certainly, if you look at the speeches that we do. Okay, so I'm probably not a good poster child because my speeches are kind of written in German. Like, I have really long sentences and I have all the verbs at the end. But but a lot of us try to be good communicators. And a lot of us spend times in our district talking to various groups. I just had Common Good Ohio into the bank, and you know, we spent a long time, you know, they told us, you know, some of their issues with the Fed and some of the issues with raising rates. So there's those dialogues go on. And again, you know, we try to talk to chambers of commerce and business people and sort of, again, trying to be transparent. But also, we gather information from them. So that it's a good give and take, right? We try to explain what our views are. Like, I go out and I try to explain my rationale for different things. But then I also gain a lot because they tell us kind of like what they're actually seeing in not only their own businesses, but their customers' businesses. That's really important, I think. And you're right in the sense that maybe we don't publicize that as much, and maybe we should do better at publicizing that. There's a lot of people within the Federal Reserve banks that work on community development issues. The original impetus of that work came from the Community Reinvestment Act, you know, one of the regulations that banks are under. But that work has evolved in sort of being a very good way of you know, studying things about communities and about community redevelopment. So again, I think there is a lot of good work going on within the Federal Reserve System, but I take your point, we probably aren't as good about communicating that to the public at large, and we should learn to do that better.
Well, before I release you to the tender mercies of the press and release our audience to the bar, I wanted to express...
Oh, boy, that's not a good trade-off. All right.
Wanted to express our appreciation again for joining us this evening, and I'd just like to ask one final question, maybe a bit awkward for a person whose profession is monetary policy, but does it concern you at all that the whole world, and financial markets in particular, are so focused on monetary policy as the be-all and end-all? Everything seems to revolve around what central banks are doing in any given country. Is that a healthy situation long run for the global economy and for the U.S. economy?
So I do think there's been a tendency to think that monetary policy can do more than it actually can do. And I do think that that's something that, you know, is unfortunate. And, you know, hopefully we'll get to a position where that isn't the case, but I see your point, and I do have some concern about that as well.
Well, thank you very much.